This is Business Weekend with Ross Greenwood.
Hi there and welcome to Business Weekend for another week. I'm Ross Greenwood. It is great to have your company. Coming up on the program today, the government right now is pushing back against the Reserve Bank's message that interest rates might still have to rise, claiming it will tip the country into recession. It comes as Donald Trump says politicians should set interest rates, not an independent central bank. Today, we speak with Shadow Treasurer Angus Taylor, who's also pushing government about who should set Australia's interest rates.
There shouldn't be a sack and stack strategy for the board. The current Reserve Bank board should transition over or be given the opportunity to transition over to the Monetary Policy Board.
Now, belying the suggestion that Australia's economy is weak and the profit reporting season so far has been pretty strong and is matched by the stock market returning close to all-time record levels. Today we speak with some of the country's most senior corporate leaders, including the Commonwealth Bank's Matt Comyn and AGL Energy's Damien Nix.
We've continued to increase the investment. We've lifted it quite substantially. We're now a little bit over $2 billion.
Look, it's a great set of results, both operationally and financially. I think we've nailed it over the last 12 months.
Now, one company that's had a great 12 months is the Seven Group. But as we've pointed out before, its interest in media company Seven West is now worth around 5% of its total assets. But to be honest, it's probably responsible for 99% of the adverse publicity that's generated. So we speak with Seven Group Chief Executive Ryan Stokes.
We believe very firmly in the business we own. We want to make sure we operate very effectively, we unlock their potential and ultimately continue to drive ongoing performance.
So all that and plenty more coming up on today's program. But look, let's start with our Reserve Bank and its independence. Speak to the Treasurer or any politician and the independence of the central bank, they say, is sacrosanct. But right now, though, questions are being raised about the independence of Western central banks by no less potentially than the next US president.
The Federal Reserve is a very interesting thing and it's sort of gotten it wrong a lot. And he's tending to be a little bit late on things. He gets a little bit too early and a little bit too late. And, you know, that's very largely it's a gut feeling. I believe it's really a gut feeling. And I used to have it out with him. I had it out with him a couple of times very strongly. I fought him very hard. And, you know, we get along fine. We get along fine. But I feel the president should have at least say in there. Yeah, I feel that strongly. I think that in my case, I made a lot of money. I was very successful. And I think I have a better instinct than, in many cases, people that would be on the Federal Reserve or the chairman.
So that's a big call. And immediately he was backed by his would-be vice president.
I absolutely agree with what he said.
Right now, and the president doesn't have a say.
Well, the president has a say in the sense that the president appoints the Federal Reserve governors. But he's saying, to be clear, President Trump is saying, I think, something that's really important and actually profound, which is that the political leadership of this country should have more say over the monetary policy of this country. I agree with him.
Kamala Harris, for one, is not having it at all.
Can you give us a sense on what your view is on the Fed and the independence of the Fed? President Trump weighed in on that list last week and said he thought he should have some say in the Fed's decisions.
I couldn't disagree, more strongly. The Fed is an independent entity, and as president, I would never interfere in the decisions that the Fed makes.
And the Fed chairman, Jerome Powell, was asked directly about this a month ago at a Senate hearing.
Give me your perspective, at least, on why the central bank independence is so critically important.
Thank you. I'd be glad to. So, essentially, all advanced economies have adopted a policy of central bank and operational independence, and that just means that we make our decisions, we're instructed to make them without taking in extraneous factors, one of which would be politics. And the record is pretty clear that it's a good institutional arrangement that serves the public well. And, you know, we just want to stress, as we do periodically, that this is an institutional choice that we make as a country, and that as long as it's seen to serve the public well, it's a good choice. We think so.
And there's a bit of irony here because the vice presidential candidate, J.D. Vance, was on that very committee. Now, though the tone of this argument in Australia is not quite as blunt, this week, senior Labor figures were pretty frank in their assessment of what would happen if the Reserve Bank raised interest rates in its ongoing fight against inflation.
The RBA is independent, but that doesn't mean that they're immune from being disagreed with. I do not believe the economy is running hot for most Australians. There are some Australians who are doing very well. But for most Australians, we're seeing their savings being reduced, we're seeing the cost of living pressures. The way to deal with it, though, isn't to push this nation into recession with higher and higher interest rates.
Jawboning or just a bit of advice? Well, that was nothing compared with the former Labor Minister, Stephen Connery, when he was asked about the Bank of England import to the Reserve Bank, Andrew Houser, the Deputy Governor, who merely noted that future rate movements would be determined by economic data, of which the RBA is not completely certain about right now.
The type of inflation that we're facing today is not restaurant spending by the lowest 40% of Australians. So get a grip, admit you're wrong, stop being a complete wanker and actually study the Australian statistics. Because this bloke's record from the UK is he helped push it into recession.
So leaving those personal character assessments to one side, shall we? Clearly Labor is giving the RBA its own very strong view that rates should not rise. Now, that if they do, the RBA, not the government perhaps, will be responsible for a recession. But there's something else here. The Treasurer called for a review of the Reserve Bank. He got it and agreed to split the board in two, a governance board and a monetary policy board that would set the interest rates. That split was due to happen on July 1 this year, but it hasn't happened because the desired bipartisan agreement evaporated about how members should be appointed to those boards. Now, for more on that, I'm joined now by the Shadow Treasurer, Angus Taylor. Angus Taylor, many thanks for your time. Can you just describe to me how the negotiations between yourself and the Treasurer are going right now?
Well, that's a question for the Treasurer, not for me, because the ball is well and truly in his court. We do want to see sensible reforms to strengthen the independence and the capability of the Reserve Bank. But central to that is our view that there shouldn't be a sack and stack strategy for the board. The current Reserve Bank board should transition over or be given the opportunity to transition over to the monetary policy board. And that's because we need, at a time like this, when inflation is raging, it's been harder to beat than the government anticipated, we need to have stability and continuity in our Reserve Bank board. That's absolutely essential, and that's not something we're prepared to compromise on. So it's up to the Treasurer as to where he wants to go with that.
When did you last have a discussion with the Treasurer about this?
I'm not going to disclose the private discussions I've had with the Treasurer. I think it's important that they be done in confidence. What I would say is we've been very clear about our position, both in public and private, on this critical issue. You know, an independent, strong, capable Reserve Bank is absolutely essential to having a strong, low inflation economy. That's not what we've got at the moment. We need to get inflation back under control, and we're not going to do that by weakening the Reserve Bank. We actually need to strengthen it, not weaken it. And so our concern at a time like this is it's absolutely essential that this transition be done in very carefully to ensure that the bank remains credible and capable at a time when it's been under enormous pressure.
OK, so this week you've seen senior Labor figures, Stephen Conroy, a former minister, also Bill Shorten, a former leader, really having a go at the Reserve Bank, saying any suggestion of rate increases would push Australia's economy into recession, that it would be the Reserve Bank's fault. Is that fair of Labor to be really having a go at the Reserve Bank in this way?
Well, there's a long history of Labor governments and Labor treasurers indeed, you go back to Paul Keating, wanting to tell the Reserve Bank what to do. In fact, Paul Keating used to crow about how he would tell the Reserve Bank what to do, and I don't think that history is lost. I think we still see it. Now, we've learned all around the world since the last big surge of inflation in the 70s and the 80s that if you want to beat inflation and keep it away, position yourself for a strong economy with low inflation, you have to have a strong, capable and independent Reserve Bank. And when the government starts to meddle in that and weaken it, we end up with inflation which is stronger for longer. And that's not what we want. We are seeing inflation right now which is stronger for longer. We've got to beat that. And undermining the credibility and the independence of the Reserve Bank is not the pathway to do that. The pathway from the government's point of view is getting the policy settings right that make it easier for the Reserve Bank to bring down inflation and bring down interest rates. That should be their focus, not jawboning the Reserve Bank.
OK, so jawboning of the Reserve Bank is quite different to what Donald Trump is suggesting in America, where he's suggesting direct intervention, that he would have a say in where interest rates would be in America. Now, he could become the president of the United States very shortly. He says that's his policy. Why would that not then become an influence here in Australia?
Well, it may or may not, but we don't agree with it. We don't think this is the right way forward. We didn't have the level of independence of central banks back in the 70s and 80s that we've had more recently. And the result was we had raging inflation for an extended period of time. And there'll be people watching this program who remember 18% interest rates back in the 80s. I mean, this was diabolical and disastrous for many small businesses and many Australian households. And it would be far worse now than even then to continue to see that stronger for longer, high inflation, high interest rates because of the amount of debt we have now. So we don't think this is that's the right pathway forward. We've seen the history. It's very, very clear. Keeping a strong, independent Reserve Bank's important, but where we're going wrong right now is not undermining, we shouldn't be undermining the Reserve Bank, it's that the government hasn't got its settings right. So it's got the foot on the accelerator at exactly the time that the Reserve Bank has got the foot on the brake, and that's how you brake the engine, and we're seeing that with our economy right now.
Okay, I want to go to the Reserve Bank and its own structure, because that's where clearly there is ongoing negotiation potentially, but potentially disagreement between you and the government. So on Friday, this is what the Governor Michelle Bullock said when she was asked in the parliamentary hearing about how she would prefer the board in the future to be composed. Have a listen.
I personally, and I think I've said this before publicly, I would like continuity on both boards, the Monetary Policy Board and the Governance Board. Why do I say that? I think it would be really helpful for me if there was at least one or two of the current board members who are familiar with the bank, who know a bit about how the bank runs, to move across to the Governance Board rather than having a whole new Governance Board that hasn't had any contact with the bank before. So, personally, I think if we can achieve continuity by some people going into the Monetary Policy Board and one or two going across to the Governance Board, that would be my best case scenario.
And does that sound reasonable to you, Angus Taylor?
Well, there's nothing stopping members of the current Reserve Bank Board being on both boards. This is the point. What we want to see more than anything is continuity on the Monetary Policy Board. And the reason for that is that that's the board that has to beat inflation and get interest rates back to more sustainable levels over time. So it's absolutely crucial for every single Australian. So that continuity for us is the absolute top priority, but there's nothing stopping those current Reserve Bank board meeting members being on both boards.
Okay,
we think that's completely feasible and reasonable.
OK, so let me jump in, because one issue is about now the dual mandate of the Reserve Bank, and that is not just to fight inflation, but also to try and maintain full employment as well. Now, already, the Treasurer has appointed Alana Rubin and Ian Ross, former union officials, but also acknowledged Labor experts, onto the Reserve Bank Board. My question to you is whether you're fearful here the government is seeking influence over the Reserve Bank Board and interest rate decisions by appointing more of these types of officials onto that Monetary Policy Board.
Yeah, we are concerned about the way the government has made appointments. Absolutely, Ross. And I made that point at the time that the recommendations of the review to the Reserve Bank laid out a very clear process for how the appointments should be made. And the day the Treasurer adopted those recommendations, he then ignored them when he made his first two appointments. I mean, talk about hypocrisy. So we are concerned about that. And this, again, I think there's a lack of respect we've seen on the Labor side of politics for the effectiveness of an independent, capable reserve bank and the challenge you create if the government wants to get involved. Now, the government should focus on its job. It's got a clear lane here. And that lane is about making it easier for the Reserve Bank to bring down inflation and interest rates. That's what it should focus on. The trouble is that's not going well for the government. No shortage of economists saying they're getting their settings wrong, and they have got the settings wrong in the last budget. And so now they're trying to do the Reserve Bank's job instead. That's not the right answer. It will not end well. It might be a good political strategy for Labor, but it will lead to bad outcomes for Australian households and businesses.
And should there be recrimination if the Reserve Bank did raise interest rates one or two more times because of inflation?
Well, the Reserve Bank should do what is necessary to beat inflation and to meet its objectives. That's its job. Now, it has to do that within the constraint of what the government's policies are. And as I say, at the last budget, we saw 16% growth in spending in the next 2 years. We're seeing industrial relations policies that are reducing flexibility in our workplaces. We're seeing immigration policies where we've had population in this country grow by over 1.2 million in 2 years. I mean, all of these things have big inflationary impacts, and it's time for the government to focus on what it can do to make it easier for the Reserve Bank to beat inflation and get back to that low inflation, strong growth economy.
Tell you what, Angus Taylor, always good to chat to you, and many thanks for your time today.
Thanks, Ross.
It's great to have your company here on Business Weekend. Well, in a fortnight, the majority of Australia's biggest companies have reported their full year profits. And though those results look back over the past financial year, it gives a chance to see which of them are outperforming right now. One of those clearly is the Commonwealth Bank, now a sponsor of Business Weekend, of course. It came to grow to become Australia's biggest company during the year as its shares at one point hit $134 a piece. Well, our biggest bank reported a 2% fall in cash profit, down to $9.8 billion. But that result was much better than anticipated. Its dividend higher than expected. And surprisingly, its bad debts fell despite the tougher economic times. And something else catches the eye with the Commonwealth. A deliberate and sustained investment in technology years ago puts it on a much higher rating than its peers. More than a third of all Australians call the Commonwealth their primary bank. It's a powerful position for the bank's chief executive, Matt Comyn.
Well, I mean, the biggest driver overall, of course, has been unemployment has remained low. And of course, with rates higher and inflation higher, we can see the real effects of cost of living on households and the pressure that that's putting on households. And it's really, I think, leading to sacrifices for people to, you know, they're not able to enjoy some of the things that they were able to. But ultimately, when you've got, as long as unemployment's low, that doesn't tend to drive any changes in losses, or it's been sort of a modest increase.
Okay, but there are businesses going broke. There is an increasing number of smaller businesses going broke. You somehow seem to have avoided them to the point where you can actually reduce the amount of bad and doubtful debts on your balance sheet.
We could. We also were coming from a year overall of we provided, as we like to be, conservatively provided for a, you know, wide range of economic scenarios. You're quite right. If you look at the insolvency data, we're back now to the highest levels of insolvency we've seen for many years, probably 10 or so years. But there wasn't a lot of that sort of activity during COVID. I mean, obviously the ATO would be starting to quite reasonably ask for some of the outstanding tax debts. You know, some of the smaller businesses with less financial resilience, probably under more pressure, not many of them would have loans. Then we've seen individual sectors which have been really challenged, quite well known, particularly in construction, which, I mean, is a concern. I think it's clearly a concern insofar as...
But you've missed this. My point is that somehow the Commonwealth Bank has missed this. It hasn't picked up any of the bad and doubtful debts significant out of the construction industry, out of those smaller businesses. Somehow you've avoided them to the point at which you've been able to reduce the amount of bad and doubtful debts, which helps your bottom line here. How have you done that?
Yeah, well, that's a function of the loan impairment expense in an individual year, but there's many other elements that sit behind that. That's the, you know, the profit and loss expense versus balance sheet as the changes in terms of provisions and for credit quality. So if you look at our troublesome and impaired assets, which are basically securities or businesses in this case that we have some concerns over, you'll see an increase. you look at our arrears rates, which is the proportion of, let's say, in our home loan book or in our, for customers with a personal loan that are behind on their repayments, that's continued to tick up over the course of the year, as we expected. But you're right insofar as if you look back through many years, those numbers are not above where we've seen in prior year averages. And so I think when you see the contrast between the experience that people are feeling on a day-to-day basis versus what's actually showing up in terms of credit losses, and you know, you've seen cycles where those credit losses can change quite dramatically. We haven't seen that in the banking system in Australia. Quite frankly, there's not been very high levels of credit losses globally either. But what we have been really focused on is making sure we're supporting our customers and providing financial assistance when we've never been as proactive as we have been over the last 12 months. We've put 132,000 temporary financial assistance packages in place. And we do that. Most of those last for about 70 days. We're finding that people and it's who are coming to us, or we're reaching out to ask if we can support them, being able to put a temporary payment plan in place. We've made that sort of support much easier. We've put in place, you know, a variety of different support measures, safety nets in place to be able to help people because we've got the financial capacity and strength to be able to do so.
So you've got 35% of Australians who call the Commonwealth Bank their primary banking facility, right? And you've got a big wedge of the housing market. Is it actually hard to pick and choose who you lend to, who might be potentially a risk in the future when you've got such big market share?
Yeah, we're really lucky and very much value and appreciate the opportunity to serve so many Australians at a personal level, also just over one in four Australian businesses. I mean, that actually helps us to be able to bank them, because that main bank relationship is often, you know, the account that you're using that you might be getting paid into, the account that you're using for, you know, inwards and outward payments. It actually makes it much easier for us to be able to identify who we should be lending to. I mean, for many of our businesses, we're able to make, and even in the year ahead, some real improvements, I think, in the way they will feel the experience of banking with CBA. Lots more work being done on an automated basis as well. So I think that's one of the reasons why our origination quality, or our ability to identify risks, is probably better than many of our peers. And we'll always be trying to find the right balance to support any creditworthy borrower where we feel that we can lend them money, then of course we'll be inclined to do so. It's part of the business model of a bank. You shouldn't expect to always get every loan that you've extended to be repaid, but clearly don't want to have too many of those where you're not able to get the money back. That can, you know, obviously has a very negative impact and has been a problem for financial institutions where things have gone awry.
Can I just take you back maybe 6 years or so? You know, when you came into this, the bank was really, and the reputation was in a crisis point at that point. You deliberately invested enormous amounts of money into the apps, into the online, to the technology of the bank to really transform it. Do you think what we're seeing here in the performance of the bank, the rating of the bank, that's the repayment of that investment in technology at that time?
Yeah, look, it's a continuation of the investment that was set in place really by David Murray in the early 2000s. And we've, you know, in Ralph's tenure.
But to be fair, you took it to another level.
Sure, we've continued to increase the investment. We've lifted it quite substantially. We're now a little bit over $2 billion. We feel that the efficacy or what we're getting from those dollars is improving. So I think that's a big part of being able to, for any business, is to have technology that makes it easier for your customers, in this case, to bank with us and to be able to deliver a superior and rewarding experience. We think that that's extremely important.
But if you work this out, why can't your competitors work this out? They don't have the same rating. They've certainly said that they have invested in technology as well, but somehow you've been able to make that investment go straight to the bottom line in terms of market share and in terms of the profitability which the bank is now presenting.
Well, we've tried to be really focused, and I wouldn't like to speak on for any competitor. We just try to be really focused about strategically where we want to invest and, you know, operationally try to execute really well every day. And I think in technology it's really important to have a, you know, long-term plan and to be trying to move thousands and thousands of, you know, engineers, people that we're trying to deliver particular propositions. We can see opportunities to keep improving, certainly in the year ahead and quite substantially, I think, over the next 5 years. And it's one of the sort of strategic opportunities that we're really pursuing. And you touched on in your first part of that question, Ross. I mean, the reputation and standing, we're a very large brand and company with a proud history, and we're fortunate to serve more than 13 million Australians. And as you and I both know, reputation takes a long time to build up. It can erode quickly, and we're really focused on that every day.
Can I just ask you one final question? I notice that a number of Labor politicians, senior Labor politicians, current and former, have been taking a bit of a swing at the Reserve Bank of late, effectively saying if you raise interest rates, you'll basically plunge Australia into recession. I notice also Donald Trump suggesting the president should have some role in setting interest rates in America. I'm just wondering about your own view about the role of the Reserve Bank and its independence, and whether politicians should really have a say in deciding where interest rates are in Australia.
I think the importance of the central bank is of critical importance to Australia, and I won't speak on behalf of other countries, but that is an important aspect, I think, of what served Australia well over a long period of time. It's also an important aspect if you think about sort of international investors. I mean, one of the reasons why they would be prepared to invest in the Commonwealth Bank, I'd say, in Australian companies is we have a reliable system of law. We have a much more stable political environment. Very important public institutions like the central bank need to be able to act independently and consistent with the mandate that is in place for them.
So you'd be troubled if politicians had more influence over the decisions of the Reserve Bank?
I would. I think the independence is an important aspect of that. I think anyone who works in a public company or an institution like the central bank, I mean, I'm appearing in Parliament, the House Economics Committee, later this month, but to me that's entirely appropriate. We should be accountable to a variety of stakeholders. I think it's really important that, and I think Governor both Lowe and Bullock do a great job of communicating regularly the decisions, but ultimately they've got a mandate. They need to be able to act independently to deliver on that mandate.
Matt Comyn, many thanks for your time.
Pleasure.
Well, from Australia's biggest bank to Australia's oldest and largest energy company, AGL. 3 years ago, it was in a mess. A plan to cut the company in half, it was botched. A swathe was cut through its board and its management. It was handling the energy transition and closure of coal-fired power stations really pretty poorly. Today, though, AGL is now growing fast, and that's partly about higher wholesale electricity prices, but it's also about a plan to invest excess cash into new forms of generation that will replace the coal-fired power stations that inevitably must close. And it's also about a vision about the way individuals and companies use energy into the future. Right now, AGL has 800 megawatts of new grid-scale batteries in operation or under construction, as Chief Executive Damien Nicks explained to me this week.
Look, it's a great set of results, both operationally and financially. I think we've nailed it over the last 12 months. We've spent a lot of time over the last few years really reinvesting back in our business, reinvesting into our plant, reinvesting into our customer. And for me, it's just all come together really sweetly in the 2024 year, which enables us to invest back into the transition. And so today we also announced an acquisition of Firm Power and Terrain Solar. That enables us to continue to drive this transition as hard as we possibly can.
OK, you've also got a runway of your closure of your coal-fired power stations, which we always talk about. You've got Eraring now, which has been pushed back by 2 years, but you've got certainty in terms of when they come out, so you know how much you've got to invest and where over the next decade at least anyway.
Yeah, look, we've come out and notified the closure of those power stations. Bayswater in 23, Loyang in 2035. So now it's about us building enough renewables and firming to replace that for our customer needs. We have a very clear plan of what we need to do. We need to build that 12 gigawatts. We've got about 6 gigawatts in our pipeline today. This acquisition gives us another 8 gigawatts, of which we'll continue to assess how we execute on. But, the thesis today is, the battery down at Torrens Island is the first foray into firming assets. We've got the Liddell battery, which was started building, another $750 million. There's a huge amount happening out in the market right now. At the end of the day, it's about how we reinvest back into the transition and how we use those cash flows.
The Australian energy market operator has expressed reservations about the pace of the build to actually get to the other side of the energy transition. What's your own sense, sitting here at AGL, as to how
this company is at least on track to fulfil its obligations?
Look, we are really confident in delivering what we need to do for our customer load. Importantly, we've got a target of 5 gigawatts by 2030. We are on track to deliver that. We've got about 1 gigawatt today in construction or in operation. We have another 6 gigawatts out there in the pipeline with some great headway for us to deliver on. And this acquisition, again, just it further accelerates that optionality we have. It's all about optionality in this market. You want to have a breadth of assets. You want to have a breadth of different assets. So we're going to have hydros, we're going to have batteries, we're going to have, you know, a whole range of assets that ultimately will meet the needs of the market that's changing. So as coal exits the market, it's about having that asset base around you. And our thesis today is absolutely stacking up. As I said, you know, the Torrens Island battery in SA, been in operational for about 9 months now. That battery itself generated a return of about $28 million. So at the upper end of where we thought it was going to perform, but it goes to the thesis of what this market needs in a highly renewable penetrated market like South Australia.
Does there need to be step change in battery technology to enable them to be able to deliver more power for longer when there are outages of wind and solar? Is that what's really needed now?
It's about having a whole range of assets in your fleet. Like today, we have a range of assets in our fleet. It's not one technology. It's not one type of asset. Battery technology will continue to evolve. You know, if you like, Torrens Island's a one-hour battery. The Liddell battery, we're building a two-hour battery. It will continue to evolve, but we're also investing in technology such as pumped hydro. So we've got a plant up in New South Wales called Muswellbrook. That will enable us to have longer duration storage to be able to meet the needs when, you know, there's no wind or there's no sun. And we've seen that over the last 3 or 4 months. We've seen what we call a wind drought or Dunkelflaut in European terms. We've seen a real lack of wind in the market. So it means you need to have other assets that can support the market during that transitional stage. And that's exactly what we're building out.
And so what part will gas play in that?
Yeah, look, so we have gas in our plants today. We have a gas plant in SA. Again, that plant does exactly what we need it to. It's on and off in 5 minutes. It's low emissions, but it runs when we need it to run. And again, we run it just when we need it to run. It's not like it runs the whole time. It's just on and off when we need it. So low wind or low solar, it kicks in, as does our battery. And the way to describe it is, if you think about our portfolio, batteries operate in milliseconds. A peaker might be on and off in 5 minutes. A hydro might be off on and off in a couple of minutes. Your thermal plants like coal that's in the market today can respond in a couple of hours. So this flexibility we have now, and we have about 7.4 gigawatts, which is huge, enables us to respond in the marketplace and, you know, risk manage a number of those things for our customers.
Because you're looking across the whole portfolio, the whole fleet of energy generation, if it were allowed, would nuclear play a part?
Look, we've been pretty clear on that. Back in March, we came out and said nuclear is not part of our plans. The rationale for that is we need to have enough energy and firming capacity in our business by 2035. We see the cost and the time to get there on nuclear far too long. We need to have that in our portfolio for our customer base. So we are actively driving renewables. We're actively driving firmed assets to ensure we have what we need by 2035.
So in other words, if it was a level playing field, you lifted all the barriers off everything, you're saying that the business case for putting nuclear, even small reactors in, would still not stack up in Australia?
Yeah, we see the cost and the time to get there is just too long. That's as simple as that. You know, and so therefore, what are we doing right now is absolutely driving renewables and batteries and hydros in this market, because we need to do it. Coal will exit this market. Coal will get to the end of its life. We had the Liddell Power Station, 52 years of age. It was running at about 50% capacity. You don't want to invest in plant like that if you're not going to get the availability you have in those plants. It's just not economical.
Okay, so then go to your customers, because you've had a great year, there's no doubt about that. But then your customers, are they really still suffering under the weight of higher than expected energy prices?
The last couple of years have been difficult for customers. We're acutely aware of the impact to customers and Australians more broadly. We have expanded what we call our customer support plan from $70 million to $90 million. We're actively working with many of our customers who need that support, whether that be getting onto plans, whether that be getting onto government support and so forth. That is really important to ensure that we manage that customer that needs our assistance the most.
But that's where you're also putting a lot of money, is into the customer interface that you have right now, to be able to make the customers themselves more energy efficient, to be able to have new apps, new sort of programs so that they can use that, so they don't necessarily get into strife in regards to their own energy needs.
Yeah, look, the customer transformation that we announced back in June is huge. We're investing about $450 million as part of that transformation. It will enable digitisation of our customer base, orchestration, i.e. so that we can help manage the customer, whether they have solar on their roof, whether they have batteries on their roof, or cars in their EVs in their driveway, that will ultimately help with this through this. So having the technology to be able to do this is critically important. We've done phase one of that transformation. The next phase two will happen over the next couple of years. We're using a technology called Kaluza, a high technology product that will ultimately be our billing platform and will enable us to roll out products to our customers to help them through this journey.
And which you've bought a stake in?
Yes, that's right. We bought 20% stake in that as well. So 20% stake in that particular technology. We are highly confident in this technology. We've been running it now for about 3 years. We had a joint venture in a business called OVO Energy Australia here. We've taken out our other side of that share of that, and now we're going to roll it out through our customer base.
Just as a chief executive, this company obviously had been through the horrors going back a few years, not that long ago. Is it easier running this business now where you can concentrate on what's coming as distinct from just looking over your shoulder as to what might hit you next?
Look, it's always good when you've got the plant running well, the business running well, you're delivering and you're putting cash back into the transition and you're supporting your customers. That makes it certainly much easier. We are in the delivery mode now. We're delivery of our strategy, delivery of the transition and delivery and orchestration of our customers. That's what it's all about. So we will ultimately get measured on delivery of our strategy. And, you know, I think we're making good headway, but there's still a huge amount to do over the coming, you know, 10 years or so.
Damien Nicks, always good to chat to you. Many thanks for your time.
You too. Thank you, Ross. Cheers.
Thanks for being with us here on Business Now. Well, Kerry Stokes' fortune was built on bold partial takeovers of media companies, largely funded by debt. In the background, though, was one of his canniest moves. That was to have the business Westrac, which holds the franchise for Caterpillar trucks and equipment right across Australia. Today, Seven Group, which owns a 39% share of the Seven West media business, is a $16 billion giant that includes Boral, Coates Hire, Westrac, of course, and a share of Beach Energy. By contrast, Seven West media is worth $227 million. Media is just 5% of the total Seven Group business today. But as I note right now, it's 95% of its reputational damaging publicity that is generated in the past year, though it's been strong for the Seven Group. And this week I sat down with Ryan Stokes to try and figure out the long-term plan for the business and perhaps also its interest in television.
Yeah, it's a really interesting question. We take a quite involved perspective as to how we look at how the portfolio of the group has evolved. We see ourselves as a diversified operating company, not a holder of assets. So we believe very firmly in the business we own. We want to make sure we operate very effectively, we unlock their potential and ultimately continue to drive ongoing performance. We've thought about how we want to allocate capital, and it's those three themes around mining production, infrastructure and construction, and transitional energy, which is domestic gas and LNG, where we want to play into, and that's how the portfolio has evolved over a number of years. But it's a very considered approach to that allocation. And we're a bit probably similar elements of Wesfarmers, but in our own take on that.
Okay, so you've taken over 100% of Boral in the last year. That was kind of opportune. The last time we spoke, I think the market cap of the business was $14
billion.
Yeah. It's now $16 billion. So you've had pretty decent growth. You've been able to bring down your debts. Almost seems to me you might be getting set up for another big acquisition somewhere.
The unique nature of our group, Ross, is that the cash flow enables us to take on leverage and naturally de-lever. And that's why we think we can continue to grow. The next 12 months, we're focusing on how we de-lever the group so we don't have anything on the horizon. But we have the capacity to grow. The businesses like Westrac, Coates and Boral all generate strong cash flow. We could see opportunities to reinvest in aspects of each business, but ultimately the surplus cash we can put towards further growth aspirations. And that we see as an opportunity over the 12 months from now. Next 12 months, we're going to continue to execute our business. I mean, I think the only other thing I'd note is in the last 12 months, you know, delivering the 20% EBIT growth, I think is another kind of hallmark of our group. In the last 10 years, 18% compound annual growth rate of EBIT has been, this is not just a one-off, you know, yeah. There's been a number of years where we've continued to perform.
So Westrac has been the workhorse of this business for decades, but where does it go to in the next few years, especially when you've got big falls in nickel prices, in lithium prices, you've now got iron ore prices coming off? It could be that development starts to disappear from that sector.
Yeah, we're more confident in the resource sector and the resilience of it. Our customers are the world leaders as far as operational efficiency. That's going to be an important factor. Our business, Westrac, is mainly exposed around the actual production volume, and that's why we talk mining production. The more earth that's moved, the more equipment wear and tear you get, and therefore the more the opportunity to serve that customer. But We see our customers probably as busy as they've ever been. You know, 900, 950 million tonnes of iron ore export in WA. We have strong coal exports in New South Wales. We have, you know, a lot of mining investment in lithium and other areas that we think will be more resilient, and gold is strong. So the outlook on the resource sector is more confident. Clearly, with price changes, there'll be a focus back on costs. But ultimately, our customers do lead the world as far as the cost of production.
And in terms of those Caterpillar trucks long term, what do you see in terms of changing them over? Is it electric motors? Is it hydrogen? Is it green hydrogen? Where does it go? You saw Twiggy Forrest this week out extolling the virtues again of green hydrogen. But where does Caterpillar fit into that?
Yeah, from a Caterpillar perspective, they're leading as far as the OEM development on a battery electric solution. At the end of the day, I think Caterpillar's view, our view, is we're going to develop the options for customers, and it's going to be what options customers want. What do they prefer? Do they want, you know, diesel, mechanical diesel, electric drive, battery electric, and provide them the best solutions. I think when we look at the conversion to battery electric, that is a pretty fundamental shift. It isn't just a truck, it's a whole electrification of the mine site. So we think that over time will become a viable option, but I suspect in the interim, the elements around, you know, battery electric solutions but ultimately going to take a lot of thought process.
Have you got any thoughts also about the government? Right now you've got, as you say, the government trying to invest in electrification, but it's also, with its future made in Australia, trying to go into critical minerals, going into nickel and lithium are key in that. And yet it almost feels as though it's like government welfare for business, and that's a very unusual thing.
I mean, I think the US has probably set that in train with their IRA policy in supporting and you know, providing that kind of investment in business. I think there's an opportunity and a role for government to play to support burgeoning industries. And I think in some of the critical minerals where you want to kind of create that makes sense. I think it's trying to draw the line where these industries are not going to be self-sufficient and continually reliant on, you know, government support. That's where I think you probably need to think through.
But I was going to say, if you were to make that acquisition in the future, somebody might need to go broke somewhere. That's the only thing I'm thinking as a business person. Isn't that the reality of the markets?
Well, the government stroke of the pen issue is a factor if you're reliant on that government subsidy and that dynamic. And you're right, ultimately, supporting the emergence of an industry is valuable and it has a role, particularly if you want to keep that homegrown industry strong. But at some point, the industry needs to actually, you know, be able to survive without that government support.
You know, this is my perennial question. I've got to ask you about this. And that is that your interest in Seven West Media now is worth about 5% of the $16 billion value inside the Seven Group. And yet it creates about 95% of your reputational issues in terms of the commentary that goes. You saw Four Corners this week, of course, came out again. I keep asking you why you bother when it's such a small amount of your total portfolio these days.
We still believe that there's value opportunity with Seven West. There's new strategy that the CEO, Jeff Howes, implementing at the moment. That is actually going to, you know, reorientate, we hope, to show growth in digital and present more of an opportunity from an investment perspective. We'd like to see Seven West deliver stronger kind of growing earnings, cash flow, and start to fulfil that potential that we believe exists. So from our perspective, it's been a key part of the group for a long period of time. We haven't allocated capital there for a long time. We've been very consistent where we're deploying incremental capital.
But it's not like you're going to go bigger into media in the future, is it?
No, and we see the opportunity for Seven West to grow in its own right and look at other opportunities and acquisitions when it gets, you know, into a position where its performance is improved. It's been a pivot in strategy, and we think the new focus that Jeff's going to bring around the financial discipline and, you know, cost focus is an important step for Seven.
You've lived with this since you were a child. I mean, free-to-air television right now is dying, is it not? It's all about the digital streams and it's all about different forms of viewing. You'd have to say the traditional model of television, free-to-air, through the antenna, that's coming to an end.
Look, it's still a huge audience that's delivered through free-to-air. I think what we'd say is that's evolving, and I think that having an option for viewers to be able to kind of consume that content through video on demand, and particularly broadcast video on demand, that's what we're building and catering for. We've developed quite a significant audience in broadcast video on demand. How we effectively monetize that, that's something we need to rapidly improve, and I think we can. And then we've got a business that can show digital growth as well as having a traditional broadcast model that's viable. And if we end up in a position where we've got a highly profitable digital business that shows growth, an effective ability to monetize that, and overall profit growth in the company and cash flow, I think it's a very different story from an investment perspective, an investor perspective, and then I think it can start to fulfill that potential. But it's a priority for the team at Seven West. From a Seven Group perspective, I think our reputation is built more around what we've delivered on the industrials and the performance of the overall group. And investors have found, you know, the diversification of the portfolio and what we're focused on to be their primary interest. So we've found that.
So I'm agreeing with you on that, you see, totally. I've just got one last question about television. That is that... is it getting to a point where free-to-air television stations and networks are going to find it difficult to afford sports rights going forward?
I think that's a broader question in relation to how to continue to, you know, find an ever-increasing expectation around sports rights. I think we have to have an important discussion around how we ensure that they're available for free, because if we're not careful, then you know, the only people that will be able to afford them will be some of the international streaming companies that will put that into an environment where they're going to restrict access, which I don't think is in the interests of the community. So the ability to ensure that they are affordable and that there is an opportunity for, you know, viewers to consume that for free is a really important avenue. And I think it's been one of the hallmarks of the success of sporting industry and broadcasters, the ability to ensure that there is a lot of sport available for consumers for free.
Ryan Stokes, always good to chat to you. Many thanks for your time.
Thanks, Ryan.
So that's it for the program this Sunday. Up next, all the latest news right here on Sky News. Business Weekend returns next Sunday, but of course you can keep up to date with all the latest business news with our daily program, Business Now, 4:30 p.m. Eastern Time, and of course via our website, skynews.com.au. Thanks for your company today. I'm Ross Greenwood. We'll see you next week.